I'm pleased to welcome you to the Peabody Conservatory's 138th graduation exercises, which are part of the commencement exercises closing the Johns Hopkins University's 144th academic year. I want to offer my heartiest congratulations to each and every one of our graduates today. After all the passion and effort you've put into honing your art and finishing your degrees, it is a major disappointment that we cannot gather in person to celebrate your achievements during these extraordinary times. We hope this virtual commencement will serve to gather our community, families, and friends as best we can and to mark this milestone moment in a meaningful way. I know that your families have shared in every challenge and every success that you've experienced throughout your time here at Peabody. You could not have achieved that which we celebrate today without their counsel and support. To the families of our graduates, we say thank you. I also want to recognize and thank our outstanding faculty for the critical and guiding role they have played in bringing you, our students, to this point today. We owe you a debt of gratitude for your great commitment to our students. I'm honored now to introduce the Provost of the Johns Hopkins University, Dr. Sunil Kumar, who will offer a greeting on behalf of the university.
Thank you, Dean Bronstein. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us virtually to congratulate and celebrate the graduating class of 2020. I hope you and your extended family and friends are doing well during these trying times. And I'm sorry we're not able to be together in person to mark this important milestone. I'm honored to be among the first to congratulate our outstanding graduates and would like to give them a hand for an exceptionally demanding and hopefully rewarding job well done. Today's graduates know as well as anyone that Peabody and Johns Hopkins requires a great deal from their students. There have probably been times during the course of your studies when some of you thought too much was expected, but you persevered. You accomplished the difficult, and in some cases, the seemingly impossible. And that's as it should be. That's as it needs to be with people as talented and determined as you. That said, no person accomplishes what we are celebrating today without the help, support, and love of others. Graduates, we are thankful for your dedication, and our hopes for you are boundless. But you owe at least a bit of your success to someone else. Please think of someone or a group of people, whether it's a parent, a partner, a professor, the person who listened to you or a cup of coffee, whoever it is, and give them a round of applause. This is a special day, one you likely won't forget. I believe that such special days, marked by high ceremony, albeit virtual, are days to celebrate achievement, set aspiration, and reaffirm responsibilities. I have already congratulated you for your perseverance through a challenging program. Let me also congratulate you for choosing a career in music. More importantly, let me thank you for doing so. I see you as indispensable to the world and to America. Today is a day for you to set your personal aspiration. Here, I would like to use the words of Daniel Coyte Gilman, the first president of Johns Hopkins, at his inaugural address on February 22, 1876. Neither Peabody nor the world is what it was then, but his words ring true nonetheless. Remote utility is quite as worthy to be thought of as immediate advantage. Those ventures are not always the most sagacious that expect a return on the morrow. It sometimes pays to send our argosies across the seas to make investments with an eye to slow but sure returns. In setting your aspiration, I encourage you to think of the long term and not just the returns to you, but of the returns to society. Do not be discouraged by what you see today. Think of the rest of your career. And it won't be enough for you to do well. You must do good. To quote Gilman again, the object of the university is to develop character. It misses its aim if it produced learned pedants or simple artisans or cunning sophists or pretentious practitioners. Its purport is not so much to impart knowledge to the pupils as whet the appetite, exhibit methods, develop powers, strengthen judgment, and invigorate the intellectual and moral forces. It should prepare for the service of society a class of students who will be wise, thoughtful, progressive guides in whatever department of work or thought they may be engaged. We as a society need you to create what is currently inconceivable, to discover what has proven stubbornly undiscovered, to reach the previously unreachable in your art and in your life. In his State of the Union address in 1963, John F. Kennedy said, "This country cannot afford to be materially rich and spiritually poor." I believe the statement is especially true of the world at large today. And people like you are necessary if we are to rise from our current poverty of spirit and culture. To be Gilman's guides for society is your primary responsibility. But my list of responsibilities for you has not ended. In the eyes of the world, you are the Peabody Conservatory and the Johns Hopkins University. The average citizen is more likely to meet one of you than one of our faculty. So represent us well. As you choose your careers and your paths through society, be sure to choose wisely so that you might find your future to be both consequential and rewarding. And may you have the wisdom to know what is both consequential and rewarding to you. I also remind you that you are part of the Johns Hopkins family now and forever, and there is much to be had by staying in touch. You never know how you might benefit from the relationship in the future, or how you might be able to contribute in a way that makes possible for someone else what you're commemorating today. I realize that I've asked a great deal of you without proffering much in return. Let me bestow on you a secular benediction. In Sanskrit, Saraswati, the goddess of art and knowledge, is described as Varade Kamarupini, a granter of wishes who takes any desired form. May your art be amenable to your wishes and take the form that you wish it to. And may it grant you your every wish. What else is there to say but congratulations? I wish you nothing but success in all your future endeavors. Make Peabody and Johns Hopkins proud. Thank you.
Hello.
Hi, everyone. Congratulations to all the graduates.
Greetings, everyone, from Boston.
I couldn't be more thrilled to be your colleague.
Hello, class of 2020. Congratulations on reaching this milestone in your academic journey.
And I would like to extend my heartfelt congratulations to the Peabody class of 2020. As you embark on the next steps of your life, I have no doubt that the class of 2020 will continue to change the world in profound ways, as you are one of the most talented groups of students that I have ever had the pleasure and privilege to work with.
Please remember that Peabody Conservatory of Music has given you the tools. They've invested in you to be prepared for everything to come. And we believe in you, all the alumni, everybody at the school. And know that you now have the strength to go out there and make a huge difference, to make music matter.
The world needs you more than ever. We're all yearning and starving for you to offer your art.
And we all have to think about, how do we share our art? How do we share ourselves as citizens? How are we productive artistically and humanly in this world today?
So I encourage you all to go. Create and lead. I'm excited to see how you all influence your communities. I'm excited to see how you influence the world with all of your talents.
Let us all remember that our goal is truth-telling through art, and that sharing that with everyone is a form of healing.
You're the epitome of a sound investment, and you're going to use all of these strengths to pave a new path.
You should be proud of your accomplishments. Both Peabody and the Johns Hopkins alumni communities are excited to see what you achieve in your life and career.
The future's in your hands, so don't forget to watch them often.
Walk out in peace, stay positive, and enjoy the art of sharing.
And congratulations, class of 2020.
Congratulations to you all.
Again, congratulations.
Class of 2020, just as we have contributed to your development as musicians, teachers, and scholars, so have you contributed richly to the quality of musical and intellectual life at Peabody. We appreciate your entrusting to us the development of your individual gifts during your time at Peabody, and we wish for you all a lifetime full of opportunities to now go out and share those gifts with others. More than anything else, we're about performance. So to spotlight all of your many accomplishments, we've invited three members of your graduating class to perform at this ceremony. We're honored to present these farewell performances as representative of the class of 2020. Thank you.
It is with great pleasure I present Peabody's 2020 Excellence in Teaching Award to Ellen Mack. Ellen Mack, you have been a member of the Peabody Conservatory piano faculty for more than 50 years, shaping and inspiring generations of students with your exceptional musicianship, vast knowledge, and deep commitment to their development. Your devotion to guiding students both within and outside of the studio has left an indelible imprint on so many throughout their lives and professional careers. Your students speak of your openness and responsiveness and caring support, noting your attentiveness to questions and concerns, both musical and extra musical. They laud your unerring sense of teaching and your keen ability to tailor your approach to meet each student where they are, quote, pouring your heart into nurturing each student's ability and potential, end quote. You make extra time for students when they need it, always helping them explore the music and find their own voices. Through your encouragement, you guide students to embrace the importance of attending and absorbing musical and artistic experiences of every kind. In both your studio lessons and your accompanying and sonata classes, the depth and breadth of your knowledge of repertoire, history, and performance offers a holistic view of the wider musical world beyond piano. One student stated simply that you are, quote, undoubtedly the best teacher I have ever met, end quote. In your own formative years, you studied extensively at the University of Southern California with Gwendolyn Koldovsky and John Crown, at the University of California at Berkeley, and at the Vienna State Academy. You went on to become a Fulbright scholar and a virtuoso, in addition to being a highly revered pedagogue. You have performed recitals in major capitals across Europe, Russia, and North America, taught seminars and masterclasses in Asia and Canada, and produced a noteworthy collection of recordings. The pianist for the Jascha Heifetz, Gregor Piotrowski, William Primrose Institute, you are also the co-founder of the First Opus Chamber Music Society. Ellen Mack, in recognition of your many gifts and accomplishments, and with our profound gratitude for all that you are and all the good that you do, it is our honor to present you the Johns Hopkins University Alumni Association's Excellence in Teaching Award for 2020. I would like to now read remarks Ms. Mack provided to be shared at this time. Quote, thank you for this award. Teaching is a learning experience, and I wish to thank my many students for their patience and forbearance over these many years. I should add that it has been a joy to be surrounded by colleagues of true excellence, so there is much to be grateful for, end quote. Ellen, your patience and forbearance with your students over all these years has endured you to generations of Peabody students and their students. On a personal note, I too have considered you a mentor during my years at Peabody, and I'm grateful you have become a friend. My heartfelt congratulations to you, and on behalf of so, so many, thank you.
Thank you.
It is now my honor to introduce our guest speaker for this 138th Peabody Conservatory commencement and recipient of the George Peabody Medal, the highest honor bestowed by the Peabody Institute. I will now read from the citation. Alex Ross, you've been hailed as the voice of a generation, a music writer known for the accessibility and sense of humor you bring to your subject. You are also a keen observer of history, society, and contemporary trends. In your award-winning work, you offer insights about the influential power of the arts, the role of the artist in society, and the inescapable connections between great composers and performers across the ages and the people, events, and cultural and political surroundings of their time. Your first book, The Rest is Noise, Listening to the 20th Century, has been described as a rereading of the conventional wisdom about 20th century classical music. The Guardian called it a book you've waited your life to read, and the New York Times Book Review praised it as a work of immense scope and ambition, a great achievement. Winner of a National Book Critics Circle Award and the Guardian First Book Award, and a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize, The Rest is Noise has been translated into 15 languages. Your 2010 collection of essays titled Listen to This touches on the music of Mozart, Schubert, Verdi, and Brahms, Radiohead, Bob Dylan, Sonic Youth, and Cecil Taylor. Kirkus Reviews called it a celebration of what it means to be alive in a world of great music. The imminent release of your third book is eagerly anticipated. Wagnerism, Art and Politics in the Shadow of Music will describe the immense cultural and political impact of the most widely influential figure in the history of music. As the music critic of The New Yorker since 1996, you use your platform to shine a spotlight on the great and the lesser known, the interesting and the up and coming. You have been a tireless champion for the voices of contemporary composers. And in treating pop music as serious art and classical music as part of the wider culture, you have broken down perceived barriers and invited readers to broaden their musical horizons. Among the many awards you have received are an Arts and Letters Award, Germany's Belmont Prize, a Guggenheim Fellowship, a MacArthur Fellowship, the Champion of New Music Award from the American Composers Forum, and honorary doctorates from the New England Conservatory, the Manhattan School of Music, and the Curtis Institute. Alex Ross, your abiding enthusiasm and impassioned prose have brought together music and audiences across genres and times. With this award, we celebrate your singular voice and influence in our world. I am proud to bestow on you today the highest honor conferred by the Peabody Institute of the Johns Hopkins University, the George Peabody Medal for Outstanding Contributions to Music in America.
It is an extraordinary and intimidating honor to receive the George Peabody Award, especially when I make the mistake of looking at the incredible list of previous recipients. All I can do is to thank the entire Peabody community from Dean Bronstein on down and hope that I can in some way begin to live up to the honor. For various reasons, I feel a little out of place here. Unlike the graduating class sitting virtually before me, I did not earn my degree by demonstrating extraordinary one in a million abilities as a musician. I have to recall the fact that in high school, I once gave a piano recital consisting entirely of slow movements. I will press ahead regardless. It goes without saying that I'm speaking to you under extraordinary circumstances that I hope will never have to be repeated. As the coronavirus pandemic has unfolded, I never felt such uncertainty, such unclarity about the future of the field that I'm lucky to observe from the standpoint of a critic. I've also never felt such uncertainty about my own field, that of journalism and publishing. From day to day, I run through various scenarios in my mind. While I hold out hope for an eventual recovery, I cannot omit to recognize the terrible losses that so many have suffered, including, I know, some of you today, suffering that has spread so far, so wide, and taken so many different forms. At times like these, we are thrown back on fundamental questions about the nature and purpose of music. But these are questions that we should have been asking anyway. Those of us who grew up with classical music, as I did, tend not to confront such questions until later. This music took hold of us, whether as performers, composers, or close listeners, and we take it for granted that it is good, it is great, it is essential. But as we grow up, we become aware that for many people, these truths are far from self-evident. Many people had little exposure to this music in childhood, and they see it as something strange, alien, bewildering. So we find ourselves having to explain it. The burden seems heavier here in the United States than in Europe, where classical music is more visibly part of national and cultural identity. Since the beginnings of the American Republic, classical music has been struggling in one way or another to justify its existence, to find its place, to seem American, whatever that might be. There are many different formulas ready to be used. We often say that music brings people together, that it is a universal language, that it expresses the deepest emotions, it consoles us, it elevates us, and so on. I personally have doubts about such phrases. First of all, I find it strange to speak of something called music as a fixed, permanent quantity. It seems as though people treat it as a utility that can be turned on and off, like a faucet, like air conditioning. We're used to hearing about scientific studies that claim to demonstrate various psychological effects from music. It has been suggested that music, classical music in particular, can sharpen our minds, can, quote unquote, make us smarter. These sweeping generalizations drive me a little crazy because whenever someone talks about music as such and its effects, I want to ask, well, what music? Is it a Renaissance Mass by Josquin, a symphony by Beethoven, an experimental work by John Cage, an orchestral improvisation by Cecil Taylor, an operatic installation by Du Yun? Each of these works will have radically different effects, and listeners will have radically different reactions to them in very different ways. There is something condescending and perhaps belittling in the way music's properties and functions are so often talked about. Other art forms tend not to be treated in the same terms. If someone were to ask you, how does painting make you feel? You would probably ask in return, well, which painting? If anyone were asked, what is the role of books? I doubt that you'd be able to come up with a coherent answer. And the question would seem a little absurd. What does the author intend? What is this book about? What is the genre? Is it philosophy? Is it film noir? It should be the same with music. This is an incredibly huge and diverse art form with many different languages, many different styles, many different traditions, and many different aims. But we have become accustomed to stereotyping it as wallpaper for our lives, a background intended to set a certain mood, a screensaver, if you will. Classical music is especially prone to such utilitarian appropriations. It plays at half volume in doctors' offices. It purrs on drive time radio during rush hour at half volume. As musicians and composers of high accomplishment, you deserve to be in the foreground. Music can comfort, it can elevate, but it is above all a human art, captive to the entire vast, complex range of human intellect and emotion. Many figures in the classical repertory were in fact rather unruly people, anything but polite and conventional in their thinking, sometimes unsavory. Beethoven is forceful, aggressive, even vulgar at times. Stravinsky's Rite of Spring is brutal, in some ways inhumane. I won't even get started with Wagner. There is comedy in classical music, silliness, absurdity. We need to manifest the great smoldering energy that resides in the thousand-year heritage of music. And of course, we need to show that it is still evolving, that thousands of composers all over the world, including those of you here today, are carrying that tradition forward. The primary mission in my career as a critic has been to try to redress the balance between past and present, to highlight the extraordinary work being done by living composers. For me, this has always mattered most, and I wouldn't be a critic if I couldn't do it. You will encounter the stereotype, I'm sure you already have, that the older musical traditions, not only classical music, but also jazz, are elitist. For me, this stereotype gets the picture upside down, topsy-turvy. Pop music right now is the behemoth, the establishment, the seat of power. Yes, the most expensive seats at the Metropolitan Opera can cost hundreds of dollars, but you can also get in for the price of a movie and a soda, and new music events are some of the cheapest tickets in town. Meanwhile, the highest price tickets for big league pop music and sports events run into the hundreds, even thousands of dollars, and the money in play behind the scenes makes the classical economy look puny. Politicians blast pop songs at their rallies. They don't blast Beethoven and Wagner, not anymore. Somehow, pop music manages to present itself as the underdog while maintaining a hegemonic position. Classical music manages quite the opposite, continuing to portray itself or let itself be portrayed as a colossus of the elite, while in some ways it is an alternative culture, even a kind of underground. And that's the message I want to stress today. There is a certain nobility in resisting the cult of wealth and material goods and celebrity. We might even be thankful for our marginal position if you measure margin and center by sheer numbers counting popularity, because celebrity is a destructive force, often debilitating to long-term creativity. We shouldn't be snobs, we shouldn't hold ourselves aloof, but there is no harm in standing somewhat apart from the world we live in, or perhaps standing with one foot in and one foot out. We are different, not intrinsically better, just different. We offer spaces of contemplation, of immersion, of slow gathering intensity, listeners to places that are not drawn on conventional maps. We are custodians of an improbable dream. Orchestras and opera houses have struggled in every century, battling for money, sometimes going under, because the dream has always been impractical. It's miraculous that so many organizations are carrying on in such a hostile climate. They endure because the music expresses a very fundamental, very necessary urge, the human urge to remember the past, to give something to the future, and to live more deeply in the vanishing moment. And the more difficult circumstances become, the more this music has to say. Let me close by quoting a lecture by the great American poet Wallace Stevens. It is titled "The Noble Rider and the Sound of Words," and it was delivered in 1941 at the height of the Second World War. During the German Blitz on London, Stevens notes, an art gallery presented an exhibition of paintings by Jacob Epstein. The catalog was prefaced with a quotation from Shakespeare's sonnet number 65. "How with this rage shall beauty hold a plea, whose action is no stronger than a flower?" Stevens exclaims, "What ferocious beauty the line of Shakespeare puts on when used under such circumstances." In light of present-day reality, he goes on, "The nobility of its language might seem archaic, false, and dead. The same might be said of the Epstein paintings that were exhibited amid the Blitz. But the grandeur that was, the rhetorical once, can operate with unpredictable force on the contemporary mind." And Stevens finishes, "As a wave is a force and not the water of which it is composed, which is never the same, so nobility is a force, not the manifestations of which it is composed, which are never the same. Possibly this description of it as a force will do more than anything else I can have said about it to reconcile you to it. It is not an artifice that the mind has added to human nature. The mind has added nothing to human nature. It is a violence from within that protects us from a violence without. It is the imagination pressing back against the pressure of reality. It seems, in the last analysis, to have something to do with our self-preservation, and that, no doubt, is why the expression of it, the sound of its words, helps us to live our lives. For me, that is what music does. I hope that these brief words make some sense to you as you go out into a strange and altered world with the nobility of your own achievements in your hands. I am, again, extraordinarily grateful for this tremendous honor."
Mm-hmm.
For the first time this year, we have included a student speaker in the commencement ceremony. CJ Hartung, a vocal performance major in the class of 2020, was invited to share his thoughts today. While at Peabody, CJ was instrumental in re-energizing the student government and was elected president of the organization Peabody General Assembly in March 2019. CJ has worked to establish new leadership roles within the Student Government Association, stimulated increased participation in activities, and has met on a regular basis with the Peabody administration to help foster dialogue with our students. I am pleased to introduce CJ Hartung.
First, be a person who needs people. People who need people are the luckiest people in the world. These lyrics from the hit musical Funny Girl are the first thing that popped into my head when I started to think about giving this speech. That and I think I'm hungry again, even though I just ate two lunches, because the quarantine cravings are real. But in all honesty, the current situations of the world have really solidified the fact that we are a society of people who need people, relationships, human interactions, and more than three ways to cook chicken. Over the past few weeks, I've spent time thinking back on my experiences at Peabody and in general during the past 4 years. My memory is flooded with vivid pictures of people, performances, events, successes and failures, and moments of the unknown. Of course, the art that was created was beautiful and well executed, but it's the people who helped create the art and the emotion, and the genuine interactions with those people that stuck out to me the most. Not the literal writing of the Agnus Dei from the Bernstein Mass, or specific excerpts and other repertoire that I obsessed over for perfection. Rather, the environment, events, and people who shape those factors that make moments like the Agnus Dei so meaningful. Art alone isn't what drives me. It is people, our connectivity with people, and how these two influence the ways in which I create. Perhaps that's why during this time of quarantine that I and so many others are turning to the arts. There is something so humane and purposeful about art and creating it that in these moments of seclusion, fear, anxiety, and confusion that we're relying on it to fill a void, to make us feel whole or comforted or heard. Art has the ability to do that, to take on roles and responsibilities that prior to the world's current state, many of us relied more heavily on people for. This concept is not new, but being separated has reminded us of it, and that in and of itself is very powerful. To be frank, I would not be half the artist and person I am today had I not spent the time building relationships with people different from myself. You all have offered me a lot. Maybe even something I didn't know I was looking for. Something that inspires me to practice more, to be a kinder person, to collaborate, to push boundaries, and to define what it means to be an artist and the responsibilities that come with that. The greatest of which may very well be the responsibility of seeing that art and the individuality and creativity of people continues to exist. There is no amount of time that you or I will spend in a practice room that will make the world a better place, unless we choose to share the art we create with the world and mean it. To create opportunities for connectivity, to heal, or to inspire the next generation of artists. There are so many relationships and emotions that I have shared with people that continuously inform the way I experience a work of art. It is my personal belief that art doesn't inform life, but that life informs art. Life is art. That's why it is so meaningful to us. It's relatable, it's humane, and it's authentic. So as the world begins to heal from COVID-19, and as you begin the next stages of your careers, I charge you all with the responsibility of being an artist who needs people. A person who champions what it truly means to create art, to be an advocate for the arts, and to be a friend and a colleague to those around you. These past few weeks and the weeks ahead have freed us from the competitive and obsessive nature that often engulfs us as artists. Do not forget the things you were feeling and learning about the power of people and the connectivity when we return to our new normal. It may be very easy to get back into a competitive mindset when the time comes, and that is totally fine. However, I challenge you to compete as a person who needs people, to compete for the power of connectivity that the arts encompasses. I truly believe that success feels more valuable when you have people around you to celebrate those successes, whether they be individual or as a team. Even though we all come from different backgrounds and disciplines, I have no doubt that we are all people who need people. And after all, people who need people are the luckiest people in the world. Thank you and congratulations.
I'm Townsend Plant, the Associate Dean for Enrollment and Student Life, and it is my honor to present the graduates of the class of 2020. Bachelor of Music. Jahai Tiger Alexander. Koyoung Han. Yuyang Z. Andrew Bowman. Serena Joy Utah Miller. Jonathan David Valente. Dante Basket. Scott Lee. Sungle Park. Anthony Pena. Andrew James Butts. April Songyi Kim. Noah Chasworth Stravell. Liam Ashwill. Ian Blanchardon. Benjamin Williams Gascon. Ernest Alexander Green. Junhong Kwong. Joseph Ethan Miller. Melody Leong. Jessica Sudarta. Lawrence Hutfliss. Nathaniel Sean Vinegar McKeever. Sonia Mateus. Amelia Graham Wingard. Jonathan Rosine. Hong Tai Chi. Yuan Gu. Winona Liao. Kevin Sherman. Yunsi Zhang. David Brian Sexton. Jonathan Mo. Taya Renee Modalesi. John Hutchings. Todd Oler. Samuel Adam. Ziying Anita Chan. William Alexander Satterfield. Colton John Hodge. Angela Che. Guwan Choi. Tavifa Kojakari. Jennifer Jun. Aaron Kim. Hyo Lam Lang. Audrey Ling Maxner. Yujing Ming. Royang Pan. Yujin Park. Jerry Tong. Ismael Ariel Guerrero Bomboot. Marcella Marie Astor. Haoyun Chen. Christopher John Hartung. Marie Harrington. Mofan Lai. Savannah Manningly McElhaney. Lauren Antoinette Reddit. Jose Vargas. Graduate Performance Diploma. Shinchi Dong. Hayden Richard Denisha. Monica Francis Daly. Isaiah Sangwon Shin. Hongsu Cha. Victor Manuel Hernandez Ramirez. Andrea Gonzalez Caballero. Gavin Wes Horning. Gabriela Alberico. Mi Zhao. Yongjin Kim. Minji Lee. Suji Lee. Xiaowei Lau. Sujung Oh. Wan Song. Minju Yi. Kai Sun. Seth Horner. Joseph Nicholas Fisher. Haejin Kim. Gavin Peck. Elena Victoria Ray. Hyunjung Song. Amy Huimei Tan. Arist Shmoj. Emma Renee Dickinson. Miso Kong. Renda Mellum. Mengxi Ku. Master of Arts. Mark Stephen Bardis. Colin Gabriel Champagne. Hong Huang. Byung Suk Lee. Alex Howard Pincus. Ubijit Roy. Manhon Ambrose Tang. Pirapat Tokyo Trungurong. Master of Music. Kelsey Tryon. Andrew Im. Seongyun Ryu. Yu Wong. Parker Erickson Hogan Callister. Daniel Isaac Despins. Henry Dorn. Bobby G. Hye-Rung Hyun. So-Yun Kim. Cody McVeigh. Jonathan Fuller Mallord. Nathaniel Wolfgang Parks. Elijah Daniel Smith. Benjamin Joe Stevenson. Jingchao Wang. Weiqia Wu. Hoyu Chen. Jeremy Harvey. Xian Lau. Yu Q. Jingji Wang. Zijun Wang. Yuxi Zhang. Linhan Sui. Trevor Wilson. Jermaine Baraka Fryer. Arastu Sharma. Jordan Colquitt. Gregory Hayes. Jacob Nicholas Lyerly. Andrew John Oswinkle. Sydney Joy Campen. Christopher Fomanaya. Kyle Lee Carney. Cameron James Welke. Matthew Karen DeBeal. Leah Drummond. Zishan Ming. Elise Volkman. Colin James Ziegler. Andrea Copeland. Vivian Louise Tong. Kylie Ho. Binna Jiang. Hao Lu. Chang Mao. Ramilia Sobanova. Yihan Sun. Jia Ying Wei. Qifan Wu. Ruoyu Yang. Zhengwen Zhang. Zheng Yi Zhang. Mingke Zhu. Tianwei Gao. Chelsea K. Anderson. Jiajun Hao. Nicholas Anthony Bulgarino. Hijie Zhang. Maximilian Kashak. Hongming Hu. Jisyeong Kim. Jiki Liu. Heiyin Wu. Wei-Qiang. Ting Son Mao. Alexander Bernard Cousins. Hang Lu. Nicholas Michael Piscucci. Olivia Blair Rainoff. Yiyang Zhui. Zhang Zhang. Miranda Joy Brogman. Sierra Brianna Bird. Mercy Ann Calhoun. Claire Kristen Cooper. Carly Nicole Cummings. Dina Lil Golan Goodman. Jiang Wook Han. Lacey Nicol Hindman. Weifen Shu. Alicia Selena Hurtado. Hannah Alexandra Noyes. Yoon Ha Park. Melanie Ray Piercy. Hannah Gail Abrams. Casey Laurel Swinner Foy. Abigail Amanda Head. Ashley Higginbotham. Beja Ashante Mohammed. Tess Nicole Ottinger. Puo Wu Fu. Artist Diploma. Hannah Hyungjung Kim.
Sua Kim.
As we begin conferring the conservatory's doctoral degrees, we would like to acknowledge that if we were all together, we would be hooding each of these students with the traditional pink hood. The academic hood symbolizes a degree beyond the baccalaureate, most notably the doctorate. By custom, the hood is not to be worn until the degree is conferred, which is why commencement exercises include a hooding ceremony. Once hooded, a scholar may wear the hood in future academic exercises to symbolize both the degree and the school that made the award. We also recognize the achievements of our doctoral students by including their research areas on each slide. Doctor of Musical Arts.
Jordan Chase. Gu Wei.
Nell Flanders. James Reeves.
William Lawrence Skinner. Kelly Ann Sulik.
James Constantine Peretzis. Jonathan Zui. Teodora Ajarova. Edwin Sungpil Kim. Bonghee Lee. Yejin Lee. Sun Ah Park. Mariana Przewalskaya. Haewon Ru. Lisa Perry.
Let me begin by again congratulating our graduates today on all your many accomplishments over the course of your years here at Peabody. You've worked hard, overcome obstacles, and likely called on internal resources you never knew you had in order to get to this point. And now you're at the beginning of a great adventure, one that will have its peaks and valleys, but you've learned to be resilient and always to return to the purpose that has driven you to be an artist from the beginning. All that said, we should not pretend that we've been in a normal time over the last several months. While we have certainly strived to create some sense of normalcy, here you are graduating on time, it's been anything but normal. This virtual graduation attests to that. In early March, we learned that we would need to move online for the instruction of our students and off campus for everyone in a matter of days. This amounted to a change in paradigm that was almost instantaneous. While we had been building our online capacity for several years, we would now need to exponentially ramp up that capability. Students, faculty, and staff worked incredibly hard and with great purpose to make this productive. And the learning has continued, not perfectly and not without challenges, but continued nonetheless. Faculty have looked for creative, often brilliant ways to teach their subjects. Students look for ways to rise above the challenges, determined to take as much as possible away from the experience. Staff work behind the scenes to support the new paradigm. I know it hasn't been perfect, and I know it wasn't the spring semester that any of us would have envisioned or probably chosen, but it's what we had to do. And while the last few months represented proportionally a small part of your time at Peabody, you didn't get to realize everything in all the ways you likely imagined. As I've reflected on all this, several important takeaways have risen to the surface. The first goes to something that we hope you have learned during your time at Peabody: art matters. Now, there's a memorable line in the movie Jurassic Park, where Dr. Malcolm, the mathematician who specializes in chaos theory, notes that life finds a way. The same can be said of art. Art finds a way. You found new ways in the last 2 months to continue to learn and to grow. Faculty found new ways to teach. Peabody found a new way, despite the absence of live performances, to push the work of its students and faculty out into the world through Peabody Artreach in the form of archived concerts, living room concerts, musical moments, teaching vignettes, and more. Performing arts organizations around the world, despite being shuttered, have done the same thing. And we've all learned more from it: how to reach people, how to touch people at a time when they need it more than ever. That's what art does. I was especially reminded of this recently when social media captured the vision of a solo violinist giving an impromptu concert on a rooftop in Italy, with many coming out on their balconies to listen to this welcome distraction from everyday life. Art finds a way. The second takeaway is that we also learned, or were reminded with new urgency, that this idea of flexibility and looking for new ways to make art relevant and finding new pathways is part of being a 21st century artist. Aside from the pandemic, this is something that artists were already facing for many different reasons: economic, lifestyle changes, changes in educational priorities, and more. This last several months have given us an opportunity, a real life opportunity, to apply that flexibility and creativity to finding new ways to make, teach, and disseminate music and dance and other art forms. And that may be the silver lining in this. The fact is that this is something that artists must do, with and without a pandemic, to ensure a great future for the role of arts across our communities. This isn't in any way to imply that live performances won't continue to be important, as that rooftop concert demonstrates. In fact, live performance may get a renewed sense of purpose. I hope so. Sometimes absence makes the heart grow fonder. And there's nothing that substitutes for the shared live experience. But it has made us think anew about what role technology can play, what things does it help to accentuate, and what are its limitations. We also know, if history is any guide, that the technology will continue to evolve, maybe to a point where one day sooner than we might imagine, it's not even discernible from a live, real-time experience. Think virtual reality. I would go so far as to say over the last few months, we've all had a real life breakthrough curriculum experience. We've had to learn to be more flexible, more creative, and more willing to try different pathways to success, and even to rethink what constitutes success. I hope you take that away from the last 2 months of your Peabody experience, because as strange as it sounds, it will stand you in good stead as you face other challenges, hopefully far less extraordinary, as you move through your professional careers. It is true that you're going out into the field of the performing arts at a challenging time. The reality is that building a career out of something you love has never been easy. It's a calling. And we must recognize the challenge that this once-in-a-century event presents to already fragile performing arts institutions, large and small. These institutions are always among the most vulnerable. We operate, even in good times, with small margins. But it will get better, it will improve, and arts institutions will be back. Art finds a way. As you move out into the field to start your careers, you will need to summon up every aspect of your skills, your craft, artistry, creativity, business acumen, and yes, your resilience. Remember that you've chosen a wonderful field, a field that has purpose, inspiration, and the potential to give great joy. Your job will be to make sure that you become not just practitioners of the arts, but builders, advocates, and trendsetters, dedicated to building a stronger than ever community of art lovers for the coming decades. We'll be here cheering you on. I look forward to following every success I know you will have, and your entire Peabody family, faculty, colleagues, alumni, stand ready to support your next steps. Good luck, and again, congratulations on this very special day. Now I would like to again thank all who joined us online today to recognize and celebrate the class of 2020. Our graduation ceremony will close with portions of special performances from this past March. Our students were in production for two major performances when campus activities were canceled and the transition to remote instruction began. On the students' final night on campus, the Peabody Symphony Orchestra assembled in the dining hall for an impromptu concert of Tchaikovsky's Symphony No. 5, which had been scheduled for performance at JHU's Shriver Hall that week, and Puccini's La Rondine, scheduled for three performances from March 12th to the 14th. The spontaneous concert was a remarkable display of spirit and community and was organized by Leanne Atia, a sophomore horn performance major and double degree student. We will listen first to an excerpt from La Rondine. Leanne will then share her reflections on the significance of the evening as we enjoy the Tchaikovsky Five and bid farewell for now to our 2020 Peabody graduates.
cafeteria concert has been the most special moment of my time at Peabody, as it was for many other students. To some, it was empowering to put on a student-initiated concert, especially as this virus has left us feeling so frail and vulnerable. To others, it was a memorable final concert with and for their peers. Some found it thrilling to pursue something so magnificently impractical, while others found it uplifting to see the student body mobilized, to see departmental borders dissolved. Many felt inspired by the unwavering determination of their peers and encouraged by the heartfelt support of their conductor. For all of us, it was a suspended moment of peace amidst the chaos. Times of crisis like these are exactly when we need the arts the most. While those who are afflicted by the virus are in the minority, all of us have felt the social impact, and all of us have felt the separation, fear, stigmatization, and heightened uncertainty that it has brought along. Artists do what they can, do what they must to combat these social repercussions, and I am proud of what we have done to fulfill our duty as artists of bringing people together and of reminding the world that beauty still endures.
Thank you. Congratulations, Peabody Class of 2020.
Class of 2020.
Congratulations.
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 Peabody Class of 2020.
Congratulations.
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 Congratulations, Peabody Class of 2020.
Congratulations.
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 Peabody Class of 2020.
Congratulations.
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 Peabody Class of 2020.
Congratulations.
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 Peabody Class of 2020.
Congratulations.
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 Peabody Class of 2020. You did it.
Bon voyage.
Congratulations, Peabody Class of 2020.